Hello, and welcome to another episode of Ask Kate, brought to you by the Children's Tumor Foundation. Today I'm going to be responding to a question that I received on a video we shared and posted on January 3rd. In that video, I was discussing NF research and the progress that we're making, and the question I was asked was maybe not directly related to that, but very interesting and something I thought would be worthy of a video all by itself. So the question was related to the idea that children and adults with NF1 may be at a higher risk or some risk for developing autism spectrum disorder, often shorthand called ASD. And I wanted to just take some time to talk a little bit about that. I think in this day and age, the word autism can be really scary, especially for a parent. And so I think it would be good to just kind of talk through a little bit about what we see as being the risk for children with NF1 and why we are concerned about it and how you can help your child if you have concerns that they might have this diagnosis in addition to having NF1. So first I want to just clarify that we really only see the association between the NF diagnosis and autism spectrum disorder with NF type 1, and we do not see it with NF2 or schwannomatosis. So let's talk a little bit to start about what is autism spectrum disorder, besides a little bit of a mouthful. So ASD is a developmental disorder. It can cause problems with social interactions. So this can mean difficulty starting and continuing conversations with others. It can also mean verbal and nonverbal communication is a challenge. So your child or you may have difficulty picking up on social cues, facial expressions, body language. They can also, with ASD, you can see repetitive behaviors. So things like hand flapping is a kind of common one that we see. It can also cause inflexible, mental inflexibility. And what that just means is they may have a lot of difficulty with changing routines or transitioning from one thing to the next. So these problems can make it difficult for children with ASD or even adults to make friends, especially peers their own age. And it can make it very hard for them to communicate their thoughts and their feelings to others, and difficult for them to understand the feelings of those around them. So ASD can't be definitively diagnosed until a child is about 2 years old, but we do see some signs and symptoms as early as 12 months of age, and we know that the earlier that we intervene with different types of therapies, the better the outcome is for the child. So children don't outgrow autism spectrum disorder. Symptoms will typically persist throughout a person's life, and the only really effective therapy at this point is early intensive behavioral therapies. Again, this underscores that need for early diagnosis and early intervention if there's a concern. So we know that ASD is common in children with NF1, and that approximately 25% of children with NF1 demonstrate mild to moderate autism spectrum disorder symptoms, and almost 15% of those children exhibit severe ASD symptoms. So again, there's a reason that it's called a spectrum. And that's because the children and adults with autism will sit on this spectrum from very mild symptoms that could easily be written off as some social awkwardness or difficulty with communicating or connecting with others, all the way to the more severe end where we may be having children who are nonverbal and unable to fully participate with their peers and with the world around them. So we also know that symptoms may not be clinically diagnosed with autism spectrum disorder early in life, but we do want to be watching for those symptoms as early as possible because, again, early intervention is really a big part of the key. In the general population, interestingly, boys are 4 times as likely to get an ASD diagnosis as girls. However, with NF1 children, boys only have a very slight increase over girls in terms of the rate of diagnosis. So that's just kind of an interesting fact. Every child with NF1 is going to be unique, we know that. And there are so many different ways that ASD could affect a child. So if you want to learn more about that, you can visit the CTF's website and look at our learning disabilities brochure. There's going to be some great information for you there. And so you can kind of just learn a little bit about some of the signs and symptoms of ASD in children particularly. And also, I just want to note that calling it autism spectrum disorder is a relatively new term. You may be familiar with terms like autism, childhood disintegrative disorder, or Asperger syndrome. those are older terms that have now all been, they're all out of use, and we call it the ASD, Autism Spectrum Disorder. And again, that's because it really covers the fact that there's a huge spectrum of ways that this affects children and adults. So currently, there's really no reliable way to predict who will develop ASD or to what degree within the sphere of children and adults with NF1. There are some things we know. For example, there's a large genetic component that we believe influences the development of ASD. In NF1, individuals with a first degree relative, so a parent-child or a sibling pair, who both have NF1, will tend to be affected by ASD very similarly. So both mildly or moderately or severely, they will look similar. This does suggest that there might be specific changes in the NF1 gene that predicts how severely an individual with NF1 may be affected by an ASD diagnosis. But right now, like I said, we don't have a reliable way to make that prediction, and it's something that we're still researching and trying to understand a little bit better. The last thing I want to talk about is what can you do if you are suspecting that your child might have autism spectrum disorder, or you just want to learn more about it and know what to look for. So I think you've heard me say this a lot of times on these videos, but if you're concerned about this, I want to encourage you to talk to your child's NF doctor and learn more about it and ask what kind of evaluations could be done. You might be sent for a neuropsychological evaluation. Your NF doctor may have enough experience and expertise to do some evaluations in clinic and either allay your concerns or maybe recommend further testing to see if treatment or interventions are needed. And I do want to speak just a little bit too, since the question came from an adult, I want to talk a little bit about the idea that if you're an adult living with NF1, the comment that was left, the individual actually shared that they, as an adult, have been asked by other people whether they had autism. And so I just wanted to talk a little bit about the fact that autism spectrum disorder, especially in those where it affects mild or moderately, is not something that prevents an individual from living a full and wonderful life. There are hundreds of thousands of individuals living with ASD and with NF1 and ASD that are living and thriving and living really full lives. So this doesn't need to be something that prevents that. But there are certainly interventions and therapies that even if it's not diagnosed very early, that can be important and helpful to both older children and adults who believe that they might be affected by autism spectrum disorder. Well, I hope this has been helpful today. I know that there's probably so much more that we could say. As always, I am here to answer your questions. And if this inspired some questions, or if I said anything that doesn't match your experience or that instigated a question or a concern for you, please, as always, I'd love to see your comments down below. I'd also love receiving your emails. I like hearing from you guys. It's really great for me. You always ask me really wonderful questions. So thanks so much for tuning in, and I will see everyone next time.